So now, Rocky really talked about the market. I'm going to talk a little bit about the portfolios. You know, when you think about it, is it time to rebalance? Well, you know, Rocky kind of showed you the fact that the markets were a little bit biased as to what was going up and what was going down, which does create an imbalance in portfolios. So it's very important to be rebalancing. We'll also look at the opportunities in the risk in the market. You know, opportunities often bring a little bit of risk. The question is how much should each client get? And we'll talk about that. And then the long-term investing principles. Well, if you think about it, we've said it over and over and over again. There's really three key principles. You want to own equities, you want to stay diversified, and then rebalance, rebalance, rebalance. So it's a investing principles that we believe in and have been working towards in every cycle, and you'll be seeing it moving forward as well. So let's talk about the time to balance. In this chart, you basically have two different aspects here. So your portfolio may be overweight in U.S. equities and riskier bonds. Now, why is that? Well, again, as Rocky pointed out in the previous slides, U.S. equities did very, very well. That being said, it kind of pushed the portfolio. But guess what else is happening? You've got moving forward non-U.S. equities that could be pushing forward. And in that, how do you keep your portfolio balanced? Well, we've got to work with the money managers in doing so. If you look at the MSCI ACWI, which effectively is the Global Equities Index, it's a little bit more out of balance. If you were trying for, let's say, a 75-25 split in the portfolio, as different sectors start moving forward, you start seeing an imbalance occur. And this is where we're going to be working towards getting it back in shape. So if you look at the right side of the screen, you've got your average allocation to riskier bond categories. Now, we've talked about this over the last couple of years, how you get additional yield out of the portfolios. Well, part of it was moving to more riskier bonds, being very selective with what we pick, but we were moving that direction. And the reality is they performed very well over the last 3 years, but you can see based on the growth that it is creating a bit of an imbalance in the portfolio. Again, this is the reason for rebalancing continuously. Now, this is kind of a complicated stock, but what we're looking at is international stock opportunities out there. We talked about risk versus opportunity. The reality is, you know, if you look at 2020, there was a lot of risk in international stocks, and it certainly played out that way relative to the returns. But we also have a lot of tailwinds that are moving forward for the international stocks. What this graph really shows you from 2011 all the way to 2020 is the different areas, you know, the number of the top 50 stocks each year by company location. In other words, where were they geographically? And you can see that every year it's just a little bit different. You know, emerging markets in some cases were really heavy where the U.S. was low and vice versa. Where we are currently is, you know, emerging markets a little bit less than the U.S. You've got your developed international, and where is most of the growth in 2020? Well, it was China. But, you know, again, everything changes. If you went back to 2012 or 2014, you would see that China didn't do a whole lot at that point. So it's always looking at the market from a tactical standpoint and making the adjustments on an annual basis. Let's talk about fixed income. When you're looking at balancing higher income needs and volatility, the first thing I want to talk about when you're looking at these slides, again, we've got two separate slides. You got the bond sector yield and correlations to equities on the left side. So you've got the y-axis, which is hedge adjusted yields. And then on the x-axis, you got the correlation to the S&P 500. You can see the US aggregate and the global aggregate where it is. And then when you're looking at the correlation, you've got 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, all the way up to 1%. And you can see that the high yield, even though it's given a higher rate of return for you, it's getting closer and closer to the equity exposure from a volatility standpoint. So ultimately, you've got to be able to balance that. You want the returns, but you don't want the overall risk. And we're going to be looking at those as we move forward as well. Core bonds during varied interest rates. This is an interesting chart because you got four different time frames where it shows you how the interest rates from a Fed funds rate performed and whether the Fed funds were going up or down at any given time. So you can see from 2003 to 2006 in a rising Fed rate, interest rates were lower. When the rates were flat from 2008 to 2015, well, the bond rates stayed pretty steady at that point. Then you go to 2015, 2020, where you have a bit of a rise and then a drop back down. And there was a little bit of a mixture, but still, all in all, about 4% over that time frame. And then all climates from 2003 to 2020, 4.2% overall. What I want to point out, though, is when you're talking about creating a portfolio, when you're talking about getting income from a portfolio, there are basically two ways to do this. Traditionally, you can pull it out, but there is a challenge there from a tax mitigation standpoint. In other words, if you're locked into bonds, it's very difficult to really exercise some paring off of gains against losses, which is proven to be about a 1% net gain for clients when you can do that. If you have to hold on to the bond, it becomes a lot more difficult to implement that strategy. The other aspect is when you're looking at dividends, dividends are always, well, for the most part, ordinary income, whereby capital gains gives you a favored rate, or at least right now it does. So there's some challenges that go on with if only having a bond portfolio to get interest. And if we are heading into high tax rate environment, that might not be the place that you want to be to derive your income. And again, for the most part, for our clients, that's not how we go about doing it. We want to take a much more efficient stance in really driving income out of a portfolio from a tax mitigation standpoint. I love this chart. Why do I love this chart? Well, it kind of tells you in a snapshot the fact that the markets are very unpredictable as to who's going to be on top and who's going to be on bottom. So this chart shows you on the very top the dates, you know, from 2007 to 2020. And then on the right side, it gives you the key, which shows you a color coordinated with an asset class. And as you can see, there's not a whole lot of reason or rhyme as to who's on top in any given year. But I think there's something else that's very key here that you need to understand. If you invested in the top asset class of the previous year, and that's where you wanted to put your focus, what you would find is most of the time, you're actually going to have a loss in the year coming up. Now, why is that? Because a lot of the times what happens is the high flyer of the previous year becomes the dog of the next year. So if you do this conversely, though, let's say you were in asset classes that were just doing nothing but killing it all year long. At the end of the year, you switched your asset classes to the worst that performed the previous year. You can see the bottom chart there, worst asset class. You can see all but one year, you would have had stellar returns. Now, this is really what we call contrary investing. Now, it's a little bit more risky to do it that way, but you can see that just holding on to what worked last year is not necessarily going to be the answer to what to hold on to this year. That's why it is so important to have institutional money managers managing the portfolio, because if we held on to a high flyer thinking it was going to go up again the next year and it dropped 20-30%, well, you know, I think we've all been there. It kind of really deflates you when you think you had it all in the bag and then it was taken away. So institutional money management is very important to keep us on track. Now, let's take a look at diversification. We talked about diversification is extremely important. It's a powerful tool to navigate through the markets. And what you have here is, if you had invested $10,000 at the end of last year, where would you be at the end of 2021 based on three different type portfolios? So you've got global equities, that's 40%, with global bonds at 60. And then you got global equities at 60, bonds at 40, and then all equity global market. And you can see the more you get into equities, the green line, you have a better chance of a larger downturn. In this case, it was almost 32%. But you can also see it bounced back pretty fast, and it's also the leading portfolio. But you've got to be able to handle the risk. That's why many people want to stay a little bit more diversified. Let's say a 40-60 portfolio, the blue, where it didn't go down anywhere near as much, but it's also not as high at the end of the year. So diversification is extremely important, and that's one of the hallmarks of what we do for our clients.